Hello and welcome to Byju's IAS. Let's take up the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper by looking at an article from the front page of the Delhi edition. The northeastern state of Assam has been hit by massive floods over the last few weeks caused by the Brahmaputra River, the Barak River and their tributaries. These floods have already displaced millions of people and has threatened the endangered wildlife present in the protected areas of Assam. These floods have even led to landslides, and both the disasters combined have already led to the death of a number of people. Witnessing such massive floods in Assam is in fact a very common sight during the monsoon season, because in the hilly slopes of the Himalayas, there is a very high volume of discharge of water that takes place in the upstream areas of the Brahmaputra and the Barak River. So the high volume discharge of water in Bhutan, Arunachal Pradesh and Nagaland brings the flood water into the plains of Assam, leading to massive floods. But according to this article, the poor flood control strategy of Assam and the weak earthen embankments are primarily responsible for aggravating the impact of these floods. So in this context, let us have a small discussion on various flood control techniques and how the construction of embankments can help in controlling floods. See, human inhabited areas face the risk of floods primarily because of storm surges in the coastal areas and because of heavy rains and cloudburst events in the inland areas. In the case of inland floods, the excess water that spills out of the drainage basin is what is responsible for flooding the inhabited areas. But the excess water in the drainage basin can be controlled through various flood control techniques, and it helps in the scientific management of flood water. See, in any area, the risk of flooding increases primarily because of human activities. In the hilly areas, deforestation increases the risk of flooding because trees act as a natural barrier and they also help in arresting the velocity of the surface runoff. But deforestation caused due to agriculture and tourism and recreational activities in the hilly areas destroys the tree cover and increases the risk of flooding in the hilly areas. Then in the plain and coastal areas, the risk of flooding increases primarily because of urbanization and industrialization. Because rampant construction activities destroys the natural flow and natural drainage of water, and this significantly increases the risk of flooding. See, if you take away human activities for a second, there are a number of natural flood control and flood management techniques that can help in arresting the impact of floods. We have natural barriers in the form of tree cover, ditches, etc., which take in the excess water and help in cutting off the velocity of the flood water. Then the natural seepage of rainwater into the groundwater table is also one of the most important natural flood control techniques. But these natural flood management techniques have been completely disrupted as a result of human activities. So this is why it becomes essential to rely upon hard engineering techniques in order to scientifically manage and control the flood waters. Two of the most popular hard engineering techniques include the construction of embankments along the flood plains and the dredging of the sediments that would have deposited along the flood plains. See, as rivers flow from the upstream areas towards the downstream areas, they bring in a lot of silt and sediment that usually gets deposited in the downstream areas, which usually happen to be the plains that are highly prone to flooding. The deposition of silt and sediment in the drainage channel over a period of time reduces its carrying capacity, and during the rainy season, when there is heavy rainfall and when there is a sudden discharge of high volume of water, the natural drainage channel won't be able to handle the excess volume of water as a result of its reduced capacity, and hence the excess water tends to spill over into the plain areas. So in order to prevent this from happening and in order to increase the carrying capacity of the drainage channel, regular dredging has to be carried out, through which engineering equipment and machines are used to dredge or excavate the silt and the sediment that has been deposited at the bottom of the drainage channel, and this helps in increasing the carrying capacity of the drainage channel. So dredging as a flood control technique is quite effective, but it has a number of drawbacks. It is quite expensive because a lot of investment has to be made in men and material. The dredging activity has to be carried out constantly, especially before the rainy season and as well as after the rainy season. And along with this, Dredging is known to be harmful to the environment as it leads to severe environmental degradation. Now let's talk about the next flood control technique, that is the construction of embankments. See, an embankment is nothing but a physical barrier that is constructed along the riverbed in order to limit the flow of water within the riverbed and the drainage channel. Under this technique, embankments such as flood walls or levees are constructed alongside the riverbed, and these physical barriers help in limiting the spillout of excess water into the nearby habitat areas. I'm sure you would have come across such embankments in both coastal areas and as well as in inland areas, and they are often constructed by using different types of materials. The most cost-effective method is the construction of earthen embankments. For the construction of these earthen embankments, locally available soil, mud, stones and sandbags are used. But even though the construction of such earthen embankments is cost-effective and less time-consuming, they are not sturdy and they are not durable, and hence they require constant maintenance throughout the year. But on the other hand, embankment walls constructed using concrete or metal tend to be more durable and stronger, and as a result, they are more effective in controlling the floodwaters. Of late, smart fabrics and textiles that are developed using nanotechnology are also used on the exterior walls of the embankment wall, as they are capable of absorbing the excess water. But the construction of such embankments comes with its own set of pros and cons. If the embankment wall is well designed and well planned out, and if the quality of the construction is good, then it can be quite effective as a flood control technique. But however, embankment walls that have been poorly designed, poorly constructed, and not well maintained, they pose a greater risk than the actual floods itself. Because such poorly designed and poorly constructed embankment walls, especially the earthen embankment walls, which are usually temporary in nature, they can breach under pressure from the flood water, and any such breach or break in the embankment wall can lead to even higher intensity floods in the nearby habitat areas. Then upon this, the poor design of the embankment wall is also known to affect the natural flow of the water, and thereby it imposes a cost on the environment and the biodiversity of the region. Now coming back to our discussion on the Assam floods, it has been reported in this article that the mono strategy of Assam to depend totally on earthen embankments for flood control has ended up causing more misery during the flooding season. See, since the 1960s, Assam started relying upon earthen embankments to help control the flood waters. But as we discussed, these earthen embankments are not sturdy and durable enough, and they require constant maintenance and upkeep. Over the years, these earthen embankments have weakened, and they have also become ineffective in flood control because of their poor design, poor construction, and lack of maintenance. So during the monsoon season, whenever there is a high volume discharge of water, these technically unsound earthen embankments, they tend to breach, leading to even higher intensity floods. Studies have shown that whenever these outdated embankments breach, there is a corresponding increase in the casualty rate amongst humans and animals, and a corresponding increase in the damage that is caused to farming infrastructure and industrial infrastructure. So the solution for this in the short term would be to frequently repair and maintain these existing earthen embankments. Then in the medium to long term, these embankments will have to be replaced with stronger and durable material such as concrete and metal. Then the central government will have to come up with a more scientific flood management technique by coordinating with all the northeastern states that are located in the upstream and downstream areas of these rivers. It will also have to coordinate with neighboring countries such as Bhutan, Bangladesh and China, as even they are a part of the drainage basin. In fact, after the devastating floods of 2004, the central government did set up a task force to come up with flood mitigation ideas for the Brahmaputra and the Barak River by coordinating with all the northeastern states and as well as with neighboring countries. But these recommendations have been kept aside and they have never been implemented. Now let's take up an editorial from page number 6, which deals with India's relations with Iran. See, we have been discussing over the last 1 week that Iran has decided to exclude India from the strategic Chabahar rail project, and this has come as a massive setback for Indian foreign policy. We had even discussed that there is intense speculation that Iran might have decided to exclude India at the behest of China, because China has recently offered a strategic partnership to Iran, which includes close economic and military relations. But however, the writer argues that this should not be a reason for India to take a hasty decision that could rupture its ties with Iran. Because for India, Iran is a very significant strategic partner, which could help India fulfill its ambition of establishing closer connectivity in the region, especially with Central Asian countries. And it could also help India fulfill its strategic ambitions in Afghanistan. So by keeping the larger picture in mind, the writer is calling upon the government to engage in quiet diplomacy with Iran and remain politically connected with Tehran despite its growing closeness and deepening partnership with China. See, to understand this argument, we need to understand the strategic significance of the Chabahar port and the Bandar Abbas port in Iran. These ports are crucial for the Rail Link project that seeks to connect Iran with Afghanistan and Central Asia, because India's access to the Chabahar port and the rail project will help India access the mineral-rich Hajigak region of Afghanistan, where Indian mining companies have won the iron ore mining rights. These ports of Iran and this rail link project is crucial to India because it will help India access the Central Asian countries and even Europe through the INSTC project, or the International North-South Transport Corridor, which includes India, Iran, Russia and Azerbaijan. These infrastructure projects are also critical for fulfilling the objectives of the Ashgabat Agreement that includes Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan, Iran, Oman, and as well as India and Pakistan, which were recently admitted as members of the Ashgabat Agreement. In 2016, the proposal to admit India and Pakistan into the Ashgabat Agreement was approved by its members, and they formally entered the grouping in 2018. See, the proposed INSTC project, or the International North-South Transport Corridor, seeks to connect India with Russia and Eastern Europe by establishing an alternative route that passes through Iran. See, the current trade route between India and Europe passes through the Suez Canal and the Mediterranean Sea, which happens to be a longer and more expensive route. So in order to bypass this traditional route, India and Russia have proposed the INSTC corridor, which includes Iran and Azerbaijan. This is a multimodal transport corridor that includes maritime transport, which connects India with the strategic ports of Iran, such as Bandar Abbas and Chabahar port. And from here, a road and rail network can transport the goods to the Caspian Sea. And through Azerbaijan, the goods can be further transported to Russia and further to Eastern Europe and as well as to Western Europe. So Iran's location is central to this project, and it occupies the same central location under the proposed Ashgabat Agreement as well. This is a proposed multimodal transit transport corridor that involves a few Central Asian countries, as we discussed, and it seeks to connect them with Iran and Oman. Recently, India and Pakistan have also been admitted as members to the Ashgabat Agreement, and it helps India connect with resource-rich countries such as the Central Asian countries and as well as with Iran and Oman. So in all these strategic connectivity projects, Iran plays a central role, and the Chabahar port, the Bandar Abbas port, and the Chabahar rail project are critical links in these projects. Yes, it is natural for India to feel excluded by Iran, as it has decided to keep India out of this project. India might even feel threatened with Iran's growing partnership with China. But the writer says that India will have to wait patiently and engage in quiet diplomacy and remain politically engaged with Iran, because Iran has still not shut the doors on India. Because still, there are great opportunities available for India and its involvement in Iran and its infrastructure projects. And hence, India will have to understand the circumstances under which Iran is seeking a closer partnership with China. See, even though Iran, China and Russia are close strategic allies, the Iranian government has always been wary of seeking a close economic partnership with China, because Iran is very well aware of China's debt trap diplomacy and its mercantile approach to trade. Iran is very well aware that a close economic partnership with China can turn into a one-way relationship that could go against Iranian interests. That's the reason why Iran has always tried to balance the extent of Chinese involvement in Iran's projects. But now, the geopolitical circumstances and its ongoing tensions with the United States have forced Iran to seek a closer economic relationship and a strategic partnership with China. Ever since the Donald Trump government decided to quit the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action or the Iranian nuclear deal, Iran has been brought under a lot of pressure as a result of American sanctions. And the assassination of IRGC's top commander, General Qasem Soleimani, at the beginning of this year by the United States, and the increased military deployment of the US in the Persian Gulf and near the Strait of Hormuz has further increased tensions, and it has brought Iran under a lot of pressure. So the only two countries which can help Iran counterbalance this American pressure are China and Russia, which happen to be permanent members of the UN Security Council. By using their veto power, they can always help Iran counterbalance the pressure of American sanctions and as well as the military threats posed by the United States. This is one of the reasons why Iran has been seeking a closer partnership with China, but this does not mean that Iran has abandoned India. The writer says that doors for India are still not shut because Iran clearly understands the geopolitical significance of India as well. Iran knows that a close economic relationship with India and inviting Indian investments into Iranian projects would always be mutually beneficial, unlike the one-way relationship with China. Iran is also aware that India happens to be one of the few countries which has managed to secure an exemption or a waiver from American sanctions for the investments that they are making in Iranian infrastructure projects. We have discussed in earlier classes that India's investments in the Chabahar port and as well as in the Chabahar rail project had been exempted by the US from its sanctions. There is no way that the United States would be providing such sanctions to Chinese investments in Iran. Plus upon this, both India and Iran have common concerns with regard to the role of Taliban in Afghanistan, and both are equally interested in stabilizing Afghanistan in order to bring the civil war to an end, because continued instability in Afghanistan and increasing extremism and radicalism on the part of Taliban affects the national interests of both India and Iran. So the writer says that there are still a number of common grounds that exist where India and Iran can collaborate, and India will have to remember that Iran has still not shut the doors on India. The writer is asking India to carefully read the geopolitical circumstances under which Iran has been pushed into a closer embrace with China, and hence is asking the Indian government to maintain its political engagement with the top political leadership of Iran and fulfill its existing commitments with regard to infrastructure projects without any further delays, because this would establish India as a reliable partner for Iran. But of course, at the same time, even Iran needs to understand India's sensitivities and Indian concerns with the growing involvement of China and as well as the future of Indian investments that have already been made in Iran. So if this relationship, which is mutually beneficial for both the countries, has to progress, then both the countries will have to engage in quiet diplomacy behind the scenes, and they need to remain politically connected no matter the circumstances on the ground. Now let's take up an article from page number 8. See, over the last 1 week, we have been tracking the Kerala gold smuggling case that reportedly involved the UAE consulate in Kerala as well. See, traditionally, cases of gold smuggling fall under the purview of the customs authorities. But over the last 1 week, we have been discussing that this particular case could have national security implications. And that's the reason why the National Investigation Agency has also got involved in the case. See, the primary mandate of NIA is to deal with terror-related cases. So the question is, why has the NIA gotten involved in a gold smuggling case which should have fallen under the purview of the customs authorities? See, the reason is, investigation by the customs department has exposed a possible hawala link to this gold smuggling case, and according to initial investigation, a hawala transaction was carried out by the suspects. And since hawala transactions are closely related to money laundering, organized crime and terrorism, the NIA has also taken interest in the case, and it has joined the customs authorities in investigating this gold smuggling case. So this provides us an opportunity to have a more elaborate discussion on hawala transactions. See, hawala transaction is an ancient method of transferring money informally from one place to another, and it has its roots in Islamic tradition and Islamic banking. This informal system of transferring money from one place to another or from one country to another originated in South Asia, particularly in India and as well as in the Middle East. And from here, it has gained popularity across Africa, especially in the Horn of Africa and North Africa region. And of late, Hawala transactions are carried out pretty much anywhere in the world, including the United States and Europe as well. Hawala transaction is said to be an informal system of transferring money from one country to another because it completely bypasses the banking system. See, in the conventional way of transferring money from one country to another, a person A from a particular country, if he wants to transfer money to another person B in a different country, then both the individuals, they need to rely upon the banking system and they need to abide by the foreign exchange rules that have been established by their respective central banks and by their respective governments. Such a transfer of money from one country to another, which is usually referred to as wiring of money, relies upon the SWIFT messaging platform, and on both the ends, the entire transaction is recorded at multiple places during the process, and it leaves behind a huge trail of evidence. But in the Hawala system, money is transferred from one country to another in an informal way that bypasses the traditional banking system and the international rules and regulations, and it does not leave behind any trail of evidence. So essentially, a Hawala transaction is a way of transferring money without any actual movement of money. And this system works entirely on the basis of trust. Let us understand how the transaction works by taking an example. Now let's say there is a sender in a country A who wants to send a certain amount of money to a recipient in country B. Now let's say the sender wants to bypass the traditional banking system for some reason, and the only way for him to execute such a transaction is to approach the Hawala network. So accordingly, he will go and meet a Hawaldar or a Hawala agent, and he will inform him as to how much money should be transferred and to whom. The Hawala agent will accept the money in local currency, and in return, he will give out a code or a password to the sender. Then this Hawala agent will contact his counterpart in the country B, and he will pass on the recipient details, including the amount of money that has to be paid to the recipient. But please remember, all the while, the money that the sender paid to the Hawala agent still remains within the country and it has not left the country. The code word that the Hawala agent gave earlier to the sender is something that is known to the other Hawala agent as well. And during this time, the sender will contact the person to whom he is sending the money and he will communicate the code word or the password that has been given to him by the Hawala agent. After receiving this information, the recipient in country B will go and meet the Hawala agent. And once she gives out the right code word, the Hawala agent gets a confirmation of her identity. And as informed to him by the other Hawala agent, he will pay out the money in local currency to the recipient. So essentially, the money that the sender intended to send to the recipient has reached the recipient's hands without the money never having to leave the country. So essentially, Hawala transaction is a system of transferring money from one country to another without having any actual movement of the money. This system works entirely on the basis of trust between the four persons involved in this case, and the only communication between them is through phone calls, messages, etc. So this informal money transfer system completely bypasses the traditional banking system and it does not leave behind any trail of evidence. But see, Hawala system of transferring money is not illegal by itself. But if the transfer violates the foreign exchange laws of the country, and if the transaction is connected to money laundering, organized crime and terrorism, then Hawala transactions become illegal and a threat to a country's national security. And a Hawala transaction, since the sender and the recipient can remain anonymous without having to give up their real identity, it becomes a preferred route for transferring money for those who are involved in money laundering, in organized crime such as drug trafficking, arms trafficking and human trafficking, and as well as for terrorists. See, under money laundering, when the proceeds of illicit activities such as tax evasion and organized crime has to be converted into white money, the black money is usually taken out of the country through informal channels such as Hawala transactions. Similarly, those involved in organized crime prefer to transact through Hawala transactions because it provides them anonymity and keeps them away from the radar of the security and intelligence agencies. For the same reason, even terror groups tend to make use of Hawala transactions to send money from one country to another. And in a number of terror attacks, including the 9/11 and 26/11 attacks, investigations have revealed that money had been transferred from one country to another by using the Hawala route. So this interconnection that exists between Hawala transactions, money laundering, organized crime and terrorism is the reason why NIA has gotten involved along with the custom authorities to investigate the Kerala gold smuggling case. Now let's take up an article from page number 9. Prime Minister Narendra Modi has called for reform multilateralism while speaking at a high-level dialogue of the United Nations Economic and Social Council, or also known as the ECOSOC. During this address, the Prime Minister spoke about India's efforts against the COVID-19 pandemic, and he has highlighted how the multilateral institutions such as the UN are outdated, and he has reminded the world that these multilateral institutions are just a relic of the World War era. In this context, the Prime Minister has given a call for reforming multilateralism by providing opportunities for emerging powers such as India, and he has made a case for a permanent seat for India at the UN Security Council. This push for reform multilateralism given by the Prime Minister is in line with India's long-standing complaint that the United Nations and other multilateral platforms, they do not reflect the current geopolitical realities and they are outdated institutions that date back to the World War era. So this article also provides us an opportunity to talk a little more about the United Nations Economic and Social Council, or also known as the ECOSOC. See, the ECOSOC was established in 1945 by the UN Charter, and it happens to be one of the 6 principal organs of the UN, along with the UN General Assembly, the UN Security Council, etc. As the name itself indicates, this organ of the UN deals with economic and social initiatives of the United Nations. This council is said to be at the very heart of the UN system because it is responsible for promoting all the 3 dimensions of sustainable development, which includes economic development, social development, and environmental development. So the mandate of ECOSOC is that it is responsible for coordinating the economic and social initiatives of the UN, and it essentially functions as a think tank where all the global economic and social issues can be discussed and appropriate policy interventions can be formulated based on the recommendations received from the member states. The ECOSOC also works with various other institutions of the UN and as well as with other multilateral institutions such as the World Bank, the IMF, etc. It acts as a platform that fosters debate, thinking, and it tries to build consensus amongst the members of the UN in order to achieve all the major socio-economic goals that have been laid out under the Sustainable Development Goals of the UN. The composition of this council can be important for prelims. See, the ECOSOC is made up of 54 member states of the UN. These 54 countries are elected on a yearly basis by the UN General Assembly. The members to the council enjoy a 3-year term, and the seats to the council are allocated on the basis of a geographical quota that provides for a fair representation for all the countries that are a part of various United Nations regional groups. The president of the United Nations Economic and Social Council is elected for a 1-year term, and the convention is that the president of the council is always chosen from small or mid-sized countries in order to give a greater voice for the smaller powers when it comes to addressing the socio-economic challenges of the world. Even the presidency rotates amongst the UN regional groups in order to ensure equal and fair representation. Now let's take up the practice questions for today. Which of the following statements are correct? The Indian pangolin has large overlapping scales on its body which act as armor. It displays wolvation as self-defense against predators. It is found in large numbers in India and is not threatened by human activities. Amongst the given statements, the third statement is incorrect, so option B is the right answer. See, the Indian pangolin, which is primarily an insectivore that feeds on ants and termites, it has overlapping scales on its body which acts as its armor. It displays a self-defense technique known as wolvation, which refers to the roll-up or curl-up of an animal in order to present its hard exterior or even a threatening exterior, as in the case of porcupines, to the predator. This unique animal is listed as endangered on the IUCN Red List because it is severely threatened by human activities, especially hunting. The Indian pangolin is hunted for its meat and for the superstitious belief that its body parts have medical properties which find application in traditional forms of medicine. So due to excessive hunting, the Indian pangolin numbers have gone down in the wild, and hence it has been listed as endangered on the IUCN Red List. This question has been asked because according to this article on page number 8, the rare Indian pangolin has been rescued from smugglers by forest officials in Andhra Pradesh. Now let's take up the next practice question. Which of the following statements are correct? The Telecom Regulatory Authority of India is a statutory body responsible for regulating the telecommunication sector in India. The TRAI Act was amended for establishing a Telecom Dispute Settlement and Appellate Tribunal or TDSAT to take over the adjudicatory and dispute resolution functions from TRAI. Both the statements are correct. Option C is the right answer. This question has been asked because we have an article on page number 15 that makes a reference to TDSAT and TRAI in a case involving Vodafone Idea. Now let's take up the next practice question. Which committee was recently constituted by the Ministry of Home Affairs for suggesting reforms to the criminal laws? The correct answer is option A, the Ranbir Singh Committee. See, criminal laws in India are contained in various legislations such as the Indian Penal Code, the Indian Evidence Act, the Code of Criminal Procedure, etc. The criminal justice system imposes penalties on those who commit criminal offences as defined under these criminal laws. But these criminal laws and criminal procedures that fall under the concurrent list of the 7th schedule, they are outdated and they are ineffective because most of them are colonial in origin. It is Lord Macaulay who is said to be the chief architect of most of the criminal laws of India. If you look at the Indian Penal Code and the Indian Evidence Act, they date back to the 1860s and 1870s, and hence these colonial era laws are ineffective and incapable of dealing with the challenges of the present world. Even the criminal laws that have been adopted post-independence are said to have a number of flaws in them, and this has directly contributed to the huge backlog of pending cases and as well as to the huge percentage of under trials who are in jail waiting for justice to be delivered by the criminal justice system. So in order to reform these outdated criminal laws, various committees have been set up in the past, including the Malimut Committee and the Madhav Menon Committee. But most of the recommendations of these committees were not accepted due to various reasons. And hence, to have a fresh look at India's criminal laws and criminal justice system and suggest reforms to them, the Ministry of Home Affairs has recently set up the Ranbir Singh Committee, and it has been mandated to come out with its recommendations in 6 months. Now let's take up a practice question from the 2016 prelims paper. Recently, which one of the following currencies has been proposed to be added to the basket of IMF's SDR? The correct answer is option D, Renminbi. See, special drawing rights or SDRs are supplementary foreign exchange reserve assets that are defined and maintained by the IMF. SDRs are not a currency, but it's a unit of account as defined by the IMF. These SDR units represent a claim to the currency held by IMF member countries, and they can exchange this with the IMF during times of financial crisis. This supplementary forex reserve asset was created by the IMF in 1969 in order to supplement a shortfall in the foreign exchange reserve assets of a country, which is usually maintained in the form of gold or US dollars. These SDR units are allocated to the member countries by the IMF, and it cannot be held by any private entities. The value of each SDR unit is defined based on a basket of international currencies that are reviewed and updated once in every 5 years. Until 2016, there were only 4 international currencies which were a part of this SDR basket, but in 2016, Renminbi was added as the 5th international currency. So the SDR basket consists of the US dollar, the euro, the Renminbi or the Chinese yuan, the Japanese yen, and the British pound. Now let's take up the mains practice questions. The first question, elaborate on various flood control methods with special emphasis on embankments. The second question, India's ties with Iran needs quiet diplomacy, and India must continue to remain politically engaged with Tehran despite its partnership plan with China. Discuss. Kindly write an answer to these questions and post your answers in the comment section below. So this concludes our discussion for the day. Thanks for watching.